The dean of ASU's School of Sustainability has been recognized by the United Nations with a Champion of the Earth Award, the UN's top environmental honor. Professor Sander van der Leeuw was recognized in the science and innovation category. He joins us now to talk about the award and his work. Good to see you here. Thanks for joining us. We appreciate it.
Thank you for inviting me.
What is the Champion of the Earth, huh? What's this all about?
I think what the United Nations, and in particular the United Nations Environment Program, wants to do is it wants to designate people that aren't usually in the television and in other sort of media for their work promoting on basically a daily basis various aspects of sustainability. So they choose people, some of them famous, but a lot of them not at all well known. And as they say themselves, for the courage of having persisted with the work as you were meeting initially, of course, a lot of criticism and things like that.
And we should mention Al Gore, Mikhail Gorbachev,
that's
among
right.
the more popular names.
That's
and then
right.
you've got some other folks who have been doing things like you. Your research is in human-environmental relations.
Yes.
What does that mean?
Well, I began as an archaeologist and got fascinated by how people over the long term relate to their environment and what the consequences for the environment are. And in many cases, you see things that are not so dissimilar with the present. That is, societies that transform their environment in such a way that ultimately they don't know how to solve their own problems anymore. And so I did studies like that initially as an archaeologist in the Near East and in Europe. And then I was asked in the middle of the sort of early 90s to start doing this for the modern world by the European Union, which funded me to look at agricultural problems, essentially, in southern Europe.
And it sounds, again, from a distance
yeah.
here, it sounds like what you're concentrating on is innovation and how innovation affects societal process, growth,
yeah.
because it's
yeah,
an
yeah.
interesting way to look at things. We're building a better mousetrap, but how is that better mousetrap affecting the
This earth? Is exactly the point. My getting into the innovation part is a little bit later, it's after 2000, and it came from the dilemma that we all talk about trying to innovate our way out of sustainability and forgetting that for two centuries we innovated our way into sustainability during the Industrial Revolution. And so a lot of it is to do with how can we better use and better focus innovation in a way that it actually better contributes to sustainability.
So basically, how do we innovate innovation?
Yeah, that's
so
a very good way to do
well,
it.
Well, thanks. How do we do that?
Let me put it this way. When I started this work, I was quite struck by the fact that most people had actually looked at the conditions under which innovation happens and the end result of innovation, and particularly from the economic side. And because our science is so reductionist, people had not really looked at creativity. And so what I've been trying to do with a team of people in Europe and also here in the United States is to basically see if creativity is indeed something in a black box or whether you can actually begin to say something about how it'll happen and what might not happen.
You got creative minds out there.
Yeah.
You're building that better mousetrap.
Yeah.
How do you say, careful with that, or maybe we need to look at that? I mean, we're humans.
I know. And this is, of course, clearly one of the big problems with it. But on the one hand, what you can do, nobody invents ideas completely out of the blue. And by relating the mental models that people have of the technologies they have, for example, to the materials that are available, to the functions that need to be filled in society, you can exclude a number of innovations that are not really likely to happen. At the same time, from a sustainability perspective, every innovation has a number of intended or unintended consequences. And so one of the really important aspects that has led to what people call the precautionary principle is to begin to think about all the unintended consequences of your innovations and thereby plan them much better, be more selective about them, and be in that sense aware of a number of the constraints that we're living with right now.
How do you avoid being too cautious with the precautionary principle?
That's a question of how you implement it. These are always the risks in society, to be too much or too little. It is basically a question to use common sense and but before you use simply common sense to make the decision, at least be much more informed about the possibilities of what might go right and what might go wrong. My personal conviction is, and this is something we're trying to do in the School of Sustainability also, to educate our students much more in thinking about alternatives, rather than telling them, well, this is the story, this is cause and effect, to let them themselves experience by giving them problems to solve that there are always alternatives and many alternatives, and then having them very explicitly work on how to choose which of those alternatives is actually the least damaging.
And real quickly, you also write about confusing the role of fear and hope.
That's
that mindset thing again, isn't it?
That's the mindset thing again. For me, sustainability is changing mindsets. And I think one of the fundamental mistakes that were made in the 90s in particular about climate change is that it was projected as a huge calamity. I think you can project this quite realistically as a huge opportunity. And more businesses are beginning to see that. More and more countries are beginning to see that. And that is, I think, what I meant by saying hope is something that can mobilize for the longer term. Fear is very often something that only mobilizes for the very short term.
Well, you certainly caught the attention of the UN. Congratulations on
thank
that
you.
Award. And thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you very much. Okay.